This is a production of Cornell University.
Thank you very much, Lisa, for organizing this, my second visit to Cornell. I do not remember when the first visit was, which is a consequence of my age. But I remember this room, so I gave the same seminar in this room. Why Seeds of Future? Well, because we have in front of us all these problems: water poverty, hunger and malnutrition, biodiversity, climate change. The problem is becoming six because problems such as obesity and diabetes are becoming epidemic. And perhaps because of professional deformation, I tend to think that everything is related to seed. And when we're talking about seed, we are not talking about only planting, harvesting, farmers. We are actually talking about food, because all our food is coming from seed, directly or indirectly. And our health depends largely on what we eat. So talking about seed has much bigger implication. Seed is related to water because agriculture is using 70% of global water. You see, the country where I live now is using, 36% of that 70%. Most of this water goes to three crops, rice, wheat, and maize, which are using globally nearly 50% of the total water. Other two crops are using another 20%, even though they are grown only on 2% of the area. Seed is related to poverty because recently has been shown that infant malnutrition in the first 1,000 days brings to mental retardation. This is associated with poverty, because these children will be taken out of school early, will not perform very well, as adults will not have access to well-paid job, they will not feed their children properly, and this will be a vicious circle. Hunger and malnutrition, you know that now we are in the absolute situation in which the people who are overweight and obese are nearly more than those who tonight will go to bed without having enough food. As I mentioned, overweight, obesity, diabetes, and most recently, non-alcoholic fatty liver are becoming widespread. This is just to give you an idea of the incredible increase in overweight and obesity in the last 30 years, particularly in children. And so the number of people overweight and obese went from less than a billion to more than 2 billion. And at the same time, the number of fitness centers has gone up by 75%, and selling equipment for to lose that fat is becoming a very big business. Diabetes. If we pull all the people affected by diabetes in one country, that country will be the third most populated country in the world after China and India, and just before US. The probability of dying by diabetes is almost doubled in the last 30 years. And it's been projected globally that there will be an increase in diabetes in the next 15 years, basically in all age groups. And even in sub-Saharan Africa, with increase in urbanization and the increased use of processed food, is projected an increase in all the what are called modern diseases. Hunger and malnutrition are increasingly being seen as a problem of accessibility and availability rather than a problem of production. And in fact, we are already throwing in the garbage bins 30% of our agricultural production. And of course, people in the north is much better off, because throwing about 10 times more food in the garbage bin than the people in the south. Climate change, many things have been said about climate change. A couple of things which are not said often enough is that, first of all, nobody has got any idea of how much hotter I hope it will be a bit hotter in Ithaca next time I come, or how much drier is going to be the climate in 20 years from now. And in fact, if you look at the two major, well, the color has changed, but these are the two major models, the Australian on top and the American on top. And you can see the difference in color, which is better here. There is major differences in prediction in with the Australian model being a little bit more optimistic, and in case of rainfall is the American model being a little bit more optimistic, and you see big differences in prediction in Western Amazonia and Sub-Saharan Africa. So basically, from a breeding point of view, climate change is likely to be a moving target. We don't know exactly what to shoot for, and most probably is going to be a different target in different locations. So nobody is today able to tell this farmer in Yemen or this farmer in Uganda what will be the climate that they will have to cope with in 20 years from now. And this is important because when you go to a supermarket, keep in mind that food is only produced by 30% of all the agricultural activities. 70% of the world food is actually produced by those guys that you've seen in the previous slides. This year, even FAO has recognized this. The other thing which is not said, which just came out recently, is that one of the expected effect of the CO2 increase in the atmosphere is a decline of the content of iron and zinc in sea tree crops. And that's serious because there are already 63 million people dying because of iron and zinc deficiency. Do our crops are already being affected by climate change? Well, there is this set of data, very impressive, 2.5 million data from about 40, nearly 50 years period, where they classify the areas planted with maize, wheat, rice, and soybean globally as areas where the crop never, the yield never improved, or is stagnating, or is collapsing, or is still increasing. Soybean, nearly 25% of the area, yield never improved, or are stagnating, or are collapsing. Maize, nearly 30%. Rice, nearly 38%. Wheat, the Green Revolution crop, nearly 40%. So in these four crops, between 24 and 39% of the area which is planted basically is either never improved or are collapsing or are decreasing. Adaptation to climate change is becoming a major issue, and fortunately, plants have an extraordinary ability to adapt. I was telling the PhD student during lunch that probably they are too young to remember, but 450 million years ago, the first plants did not have leaves, because at that time, the CO2 content of the atmosphere was 15 times higher, and therefore, there was no need of leaves. A few stomata on the stem would be enough. Then, between 400 and 350 million years ago, the CO2 content started going down, and it took 50 million years, but the plants did it. They developed leaves. So if you think about this complex structure, and this was only because there was enough diversity to do it. Now, as a further demonstration, there were samples of leaves of these five tree species collected at the time of Darwin at about 1820, 1840, and kept in the herbarium of the Department of Botany at the University of Cambridge. And they were sampled again in 2000, and look at the decline in the frequency of stomata as a response to the increase of CO2 in the atmosphere. Biodiversity is pretty much at the center of discussion. And here you see this is a classroom in a university in Iran where I go often, and they often invite me to give lectures. And these students added to the banner, "Biodiversity is our life." There is a global recognition that is essential to secure global food supply. The reduction of biodiversity has been documented. Everybody agrees on these figures of 75% of diversity of agricultural crops which have been lost, the same for the fisheries. And there is an estimate that if the temperature goes up more than 3.5 degrees, 70% of the species will not make it. Now here, I think that there is a big contradiction in science, because on one side, many of the top scientific journals are publishing often these papers warning about the danger in the decline of biodiversity. And on the other side, the science, which is producing the seed that most of our farmers are planting, has gone almost exclusively in the last 40 years towards uniformity. And all this is again associated with health, because this tendency of plant breeding towards uniformity has of course caused an increased uniformity in the food that we eat. Now, if we eat increasingly uniform food, why we should have this big diversity in the flora of our intestine? And this paper thinks that they found a trend between the decline of biodiversity in our gut with increased frequency of diseases with an inflammatory base like asthma and several types of cancer. And the uniformity of food is also associated with the fact that most of our food is basically produced by these companies, so that are you sure that you are the one deciding what you are going to eat tonight? And how long will it take to have this extraordinary extra light Coca-Cola? So we have this uniformity dominated agriculture, which is basically where the seed market is dominated by relatively few companies. Well, we all know these data. The same companies, some of the same companies are also controlling the global pesticide market. This is basically a lot of money, because both markets are worth billions of dollars. Now, concerning pesticide, there was recently a conference of medical doctors, and they, and I'm quoting them, they say that out of the most of the 12 most dangerous chemicals, 9 are pesticides. They are mostly affecting children. They are evitable because a famous entomologist, Pimentel, is quoting a lot of data indicating that most of the pests have got natural enemies or resistance, and each insect pest has as many as 10, 15 natural enemies. And again, we go back to the issue that also pesticides very often end up in the food chain and end up in our plate. So what is the solution then? GMO crops, in my opinion, cannot be the solution because they ignore the fundamental theorem of natural selection. Which says, this for PhD students should be accessible, for many others is not, but it's basically predicting the rate of change as a ratio between the variance for additive genetic fitness and the means fitness. In simple terms, it says that when the environment surrounding a living organism changes, that living organism evolves to get adjusted to the new environment. And the speed of this adaptation depends on the amount of additive genetic variance for fitness. You know the example of cotton in this country. It came in 1997. In 2004, farmers start describing the first resistant weed. In 2012, 92% of the farmers in Georgia had to hand weed half of their cotton. And this is happening with all GMOs. So sooner or later, because And this is equivalent to, you remember the famous discussion about horizontal and vertical resistance. I mean, this is the same mechanism of vertical resistance. It ends up by selecting an organism which is able to overcome that resistance. Using the terminology of Robinson, the vertical resistance and GMOs are within the evolutionary ability of the organism to overcome that resistance, while horizontal resistance, and we will see now mixtures, are beyond that evolutionary potential. So this happened basically everywhere. So in the best of the hypothesis, they can be a quick fix, which is only temporary, and which is likely to create another problem, which requires another GMOs. When I discussed this idea in this paper, which took quite a while to be accepted, one of the criticisms was that I did not consider the second generation GMO crops for resistant to herbicides. In fact, if you look at the literature, weeds have already developed resistance, multiple resistance to more than one herbicide. So there are several species with combined resistance to more herbicide. So that when you see this extraordinary success of GMOs in US, but you also see the monopoly of the seed market, you wonder whether it's a problem of, is it actually a commercial success or is it a problem of choice of seed on the market. The use of pesticides has not gone down, with very few exceptions. These are data from projection from USDA, and in general, there's been a substantial increase in the number and volume of herbicide applied. Organic agriculture can be the solution because it minimizes soil erosion, reduces water loss, uses organic fertilizer, use crop rotation, but most importantly, it promotes evenness among enemies so that organic agriculture doesn't put any pressure on the organism, weeds, insects, and diseases to evolve because it allows them to reproduce. So in fact, in organic agriculture, you always have a little bit of damage, but not that much to affect yield. Now, the problem is that yields are generally lower, and there has been four meta-analyses published in the last 5-6 years. But the problem is that all these comparisons are biased by the fact that we are comparing varieties which have been bred for organic for conventional agriculture, and we plant them under organic conditions. Now, how did we go from this diversity, which was available until even in agriculture, and is still available in some countries, to this uniformity? Well, if you look at the evolution of plant breeding, for millennia was done in a very different way from what we do today by farmers. And typically, farmers were selecting for specific adaptation to their own conditions. And therefore, because each one was selecting different things, there was diversity both between and within land races, and this resulted in resilience both at the farmer level and the global level. Now, with the with the beginning of scientific plant breeding, the major change was from selection for specific adaptation to selection for wild adaptation. And this found its best expression in the Green Revolution, which was a term which was used by the then director of the USAID, and is a technology based on the concept of a package. It was a variety, irrigation, fertilizer, pesticide, and mechanization. So basically what happened, that if you are in a reserve station and you are addressing a multitude of different environments, a very smart way of solving the problem is that you put fertilizer, you put irrigation, you put fertilizer and irrigation, pesticides, so you make all this environment as similar as possible so that the same variety can fit in all of them. And basically, if you think about, because of this package, Green Revolution at that time privileged food security over food safety. And we are still, and in fact, what happened was that there was an increase in production, the energy level remained constant, but there was a decline in protein. We are talking about global food supply. there was a decline in iron and decline in zinc, so that now we have to eat 4%, 23%, and 6% more cereals to satisfy the daily requirement in protein, iron, and zinc. So what we then we can do, if this has been partially associated with the way in which we are doing plum breeding, how can we change plum breeding to make things different? Now, I'm talking about plum breeding in general and not selection in particular, because when we are talking about molecular breeding and genomic selection, this is not affecting the efficiency of a breeding program, but it's affecting the precision in which we are doing selection, which is one stage in plum breeding. But how efficient is this process? Well, usually, particularly public institutions are measuring the efficiency in terms of response to selection and in terms of number of variety released. Now, what I've been suggesting is that the response to selection should be weighted against time, because different methods are different in timing, and one should consider the number of varieties adopted rather than the number of variety released, and one should consider also other elements such as the benefit, the cost-benefit ratio, and the increase of biodiversity. So a fundamental problem in plum breeding is the relationship between selection environment and target environment, which usually in formal plum breeding are different, except in Australia, where most of the breeding programs take place in the farmers' fields. And given that response to selection depends on heritability, and the heritability, you know, you all know this formula, is depending on genotype-environment interaction and environmental variation, we can take care of this with good experimental design and statistical analysis. And remembering that G by E is made up of genotype by location, genotype by years, and genotype by location by years, if we set up our program in such a way that we can distinguish between between genotype by location and genotype by years, and we found that the genotype by location is repeatable, then we can split our population of target environment in subgroups in such a way that within each group the variance due to genotype by location interaction is less, therefore heritability is higher, and the response to selection is higher. But is this formula really useful? Because it's actually measuring the response to selection in the environment where we are making selection. But we don't want to do varieties for the recess station. We want to do varieties for the outside world. And then what we should use is actually a formula of correlated response to selection. I do the selection here, and I measure it there. And this introduced the genetic correlation coefficient. This was one of the major contributions of Falconer when he said that the same trait measured in two different environments should be dealt with as two different traits. And because despite of the relationship between heritability, it all depends on the genetic correlation coefficient, which is always less than one. So the way of increasing this is to make the selection environment and the target environment as similar as possible. And how you do that? By selecting the target environments, making selection environment and target environment the same. But this is what farmers have already done. They've been selecting in their own environments when they selected for specific adaptation. But this is also the basic principle of participatory plum breeding, that you do selection in the same environment. And this is what we call decentralization, which is expected to increase response to selection, but which is usually met with a lot of resistance by many scientists. It's so much more comfortable to work within the recess station than to go outside. And the reason for this resistance is justified by saying, well, at the beginning of a breeding program, we have a lot of lines, very little seed of each line, so we prefer to do a lot of replication on station, and therefore we have no seed left to work outside. But today, the tendency is actually to do less replication and use that seed for to do more location by using a new experimental design, like the partially replicated design, randomized with optimized randomization, and using row and column design and spatial analysis to increase the precision. So that then you can use the little seed that you have to do less replication and use the extra seed to actually add more location right at the beginning of a breeding program. And the other reason that they often said, but recessed stations are so much more precise. Are they? This is a picture I took a few days ago in the campus of ICRISA, at one of the international centers. Look at this plot. Decentralization per se will not increase adoption, because adoption is a very complex decision that the farmers have to take. It's difficult to predict, depends on gender, crop, environment, and is difficult to measure. That's why it's much more easy to measure the number of variety released. So to make a breeding program more efficient, one can think about combining decentralization and farmer participation, because decentralization increases heritability and therefore response to selection, and farmer participation increases adoption. So this is what I've been trying to do starting in 1995, but actually the first idea came from here. Do you know a guy by the name of Herbert Weber, who in 1908 published this paper, Plum Breeding for Farmers? And without knowing it, I published this manual, and the only difference is that there is a width instead of a form. So what is all about? Well, if this is a breeding program where you have generally crosses, but other methods of including genetic material, this new genetic material includes also material coming from genomic selection and marker-assisted selection, as you will see in a minute. The main aspect of this is that most of this work is done on station. In some countries, these steps in farmer's field is necessary for the registration of varieties, and all the decisions are taken by the breeder. Now, in a participatory breeding program, the difference, I mean, the stages are still the same, but many more stages take place in farmer's field, and the decisions are shared with the farmer's community. There is a form of participation, which is known as participatory variety selection, where the difference is that at the stage where the material goes out of the farmer's, of the recess station, is delayed. And here the problem is that the farmers have much less choice to make. So that in a conventional breeding program, you have hundreds of thousands of crosses segregated in populations, and then selection, and few lines, and then the lines get a name and get registered, and then you start the production of certified seed. And then, only then, a farmer have a possibility of deciding whether all this work was actually useful. And in many developing countries, all these names of variety release are basically names in the file. Now, in participatory plum breeding, you start from the same starting point. This is done by the scientists of station, creating all this diversity, but then the diversity goes in farmers' fields. And this can be anything, could be pure lines, population, clones, and so on. Farmers evaluate the material. The process is as inclusive as possible. And the major difference is that because the farmers are living with the process, they start expressing initial adoption during the process, so that and they start multiplying the seed. So this does not exclude going to the official channel, but basically what happened is that it changes the relationship between adoption and release. While in the conventional, you first release and then perhaps you get adoption, here you start getting adoption and then you release what has been already partially adopted. So scientific is the same thing, is that there is this transfer of material from station to farmer's field, the sharing of decision, and the other aspect is that you can replicate all these in as many villages as possible. This is where I was working for about 30 years. These are the blue are the recess station of the ministry, and the red color are the villages. And the main difference here is that each village is considered to be as an independent selection site. So we select in that village regardless of how the material performs in other villages. And basically, we go from an initial stage. This was the program in Syria, which was the largest one. This is 200 plots with 160 types of barley. Farmers do the selection. What is selected goes in stage two, which is, of course, less entries, replicated trials, bigger plots. And the process continues until in stage four, you start already having half an hectare plots. And each year, there is a new stage starting. So when the program is fully implemented, in a village, you can find trials in stage one, stage two, stage three, stage four. This can be very demanding for some countries and some national programs. So we have a simplified version where a new cycle starts at the end of the previous cycle, so that this is more manageable. So in each stage, the farmers are evaluating the material. We take a number of measures. These are analyzed using those methods that I said before. And farmers are using this data to decide what goes from one stage to the next. So this was done in a number of places, different environment, different social context, irrigated and non-irrigated, recently under organic conditions in Italy, and with a number of crops, both cross-pollinated and self-pollinated. Genomic assisted breeding is fully compatible with this, with participatory prime breeding. This is a recent figure published by Rajiv and Susan. And as you see, here there is all the different genomics method. But I would like to draw your attention on the last bit of this figure, which says, identify and recombine superior genotypes, multi-environment testing, and improve varieties for farmers. And I'm wondering who identifies, where, superior where for what? Multi-environment testing, you know, is the bread and butter of any breeding program. But who are the best lines which goes into the multi-environment testing? So this is where I think participatory prime breeding can be combined in a molecular breeding program to make sure that all this work is then translated for varieties in varieties for farmers. Otherwise, farmers may not be anything, may not see anything coming out of that work. Okay, now moving from participatory to from conventional to participatory. For some breeders, it's considered to be impossible. For some, it's a very dangerous thing to do. For some, it's a long process. For some, it's full of sight. But for some, he's seeing the light. And but there is a weak point. And the weak point is that because of this need of collaboration between institutions and farmers, what I found is that the attitude of institutions and scientists is sometimes negative, sometimes unpredictable, and even worse is mutable. I like to tell the story of rise and fall of participatory prime breeding in Kermanshah in Iran, which is a country that where I started this work back in 2006. Kermanshah is this place down here, much closer to Baghdad than to Tehran. And Mr. Rointon, who was at that time the director of the provincial offices, was absolutely enthusiastic. So he participated in the first meetings in the mosque. Very quickly, the program spread throughout all the province. Then he started calling his colleagues in other provinces, so we start spreading outside. But then one day, I arrived in Tehran in the middle of the night, and Dr. Khatija Razawi was waiting for me at the airport and told me, Salvatore, bad news, Mr. Rointer has been removed, and we have been told that you are not welcome in that province. So the program was ended by one day, from one day to another. The program is still continuing. In fact, we are expanding to rice and to maize, to rice in the north and to maize in the south. But then again, this was a sort of warning signal that if the Research Institute stops supporting the program, then where we are going, what will be the future? And the future, we thought, was to combine participation with evolution, basically without inventing anything new. This was all published in 1956 by called Sanneson, an evolutionary plant breeding method, but was based on work done in Davis, California by Harlan and by Robert Allard, and basically consists in making big mixtures, as big as you can, possibly with segregating population, but also with fixed material, and let this material, these populations evolve in the area which are your target environment, which could be many. And what happened is that you plant and harvest, and during this process, because of the crosses, which also in a self-pollinated crop always happen, the seed that you harvest is never the seed that you planted, genetically speaking. So the population is evolving, and is evolving, adapting to all changes, including those climate changes, without necessarily knowing now what the climate is going to be, because it's got all the time to slowly adjust. So basically what we do, we are using the fundamental theorem of natural selection to our own advantage, exploiting the evolutionary capability of our crops. But you can also use these populations to select material for the participatory breeding program. So we started with a huge population of barley when I was still in Syria with 1,600 F2s, and then the following year we made one of durum wheat and bread wheat. And this went to many countries, one of which was Iran, where this methodology ran me into problems, because originally evolutionary was translated into revolutionary, which is not the right word to use in that country. But it spread to many provinces. So these are some pictures of in different villages. So this is barley. This is the province in which I cannot travel, but the evolutionary population can. And this is bread wheat. This has been made locally. This work is going on also in Jordan and in Ethiopia. In Ethiopia, the population has been made with locally adapted material. And now we have rice in Iran, we have maize in Iran, and we have rice in India. As you know, there is some work here in Washington State on mixtures. Now, this material went to Italy through the Italian Association for Organic Agriculture, and spread throughout most of the regions, and some local institutions start using it for some squash, tomato, maize and beans. So these are other pictures about. And what happened very often is that, like in this case, they use this idea to make their own local evolutionary population with locally adapted material. And this is summer squash. This actually was done by intercrossing 11 commercial hybrids. So it's something that basically a farmer can do by himself. Go to the market, buy different hybrids, mix them in a salad bowl, plant the seed, and this is what he gets. In some cases, the farmers start using this as a selection, so that the process is that while the population is evolving at intervals, which the farmers and the scientists can decide, they can select and get new varieties. So it's likely. Is like to have, I mean, this is what we've done already in the Jordan, so these are hedgerows coming from these individual spike selection. So for the farmers, it's like having a gene banks in their hand, the gene banks which is evolving with time, and they are usually advised to store the seed every year so that in case of a major disaster, they don't lose all the past work. So basically, going back to the question, if the Research Institute stops from providing technical backstopping to the program, then the place is replaced by the evolutionary population. And this is fully in the hands of the farmers. This is what we thought. And then the Iranian farmers, who are always like to do something new, I found that they were actually using a locally made evolutionary population of bread wheat, a little bit less complex, about 100 varieties, to start making bread with a mixture. They had some initial difficulties, and then particularly this group of women, they made up a small company, and this bread is becoming a major commercial success in a number of villages because they discover it has curative properties, can be eaten even by people allergic to gluten. And now there is this lady who is running the company, and I met her for the first time last June, and she was telling me that demand for this bread is so high that very often she doesn't have enough supply to satisfy the demand. We are now doing the same, so that in the case of Iran, what we found was not only that these populations have higher yields, better weed control, and better control of pests of diseases, but actually they become a crop which produce a product which is economically profitable. So we are doing this now in a number of countries, including Italy, where I have a sister-in-law who is allergic to gluten, and she's baking her own bread with this mixture and is making all sorts of different products. There is quite a lot of evidence that evolutionary populations actually do evolve. There have been some arguments against, one of which is that under harsh conditions, even though there is a strong selection pressure, the irritability may be too low for evolving. And under good conditions, there is a high irritability, but there is low selection pressure. Another argument is by Denison, the author of this book, Darwinian Agriculture. And he said that natural selection has got 10,000 years to work out things, so what you expect. And I mean, both objections are basically proved to be not correct by a lot of scientific evidence. This is historical data on the evolution of powdery mildew resistance in composite crosses. This is work done in Davis, California, with different type of mixtures, double haploid lines and composite cross, with the composite cross evolving much faster, particularly within the region of adaptation. Mixtures of rice, variety of rice planted in alternate strips, which control blast much better than the monoculture. It was also in crop self-pollinated crops. There is this classical experiment by Moran with a nematode. But this nematode is basically equivalent to a self-pollinated crop because it's made of hermaphrodite and males. But most of the reproduction is by hermaphrodite. So it's basically a self-pollinated crop with about 5% outcrossing. So what they did, they changed the mating system by mutation, inducing 100% crossing and 100% selfing. They put all this material in under the pressure of a virulent bacterial pathogen for 40 generations. And what they found is that the 100% selfing did not make it. The 100% crossing made it very quickly. But surprisingly, the wild type with just 5% outcrossing was able to make it, and the frequency of outcrossing increased. There is this experiment by a German scientist on lentil. He made this evolving these populations in different environments, and he found significant differences for things like seed yield, seed weight, and beginning of flowering. In Italy, we have this population evolving in two contrasting regions. And last year we ran, it's only 1 year experiment, we tested the two in both location, plus one farmer selection. And what we found was in Tuscany, the material evolving in that region and the farmer selection were much better than the one evolving in Sicily. And in Sicily was just the other way around. So that's an indicator, this is about 4 years of evolution. So the change is rather quick. In per millet in Niger, there's been an increase in the drought. You can see that the 200 millimeter ISO height was at 17 degrees latitude. It's gone down now to nearly 16. And at the same time, the size of these circles is proportional to the earliness. And you can see that there has been an increase in small circle in this period of time. Similar data are coming from Israel. They compare the wild wheat and wild barley from 10 different locations each, collected in 1980, this is the green bar, and 28 years later, in 2008. And you see, in all cases, there is a significant increase in hernias. So, it seems to me that if they want, institutions can do plant breeding in a different way, and addressing some major global issues, even working at individual farmer levels. Because if hunger is not a problem of production, but a problem of accessibility, by working at this level, you can increase the amount of food straight in the hands of the farmers. There is an effect in biodiversity, because being decentralized and based on specific adaptation, of course, it selects varieties which differ from country to country, from village to village, and very often, depending on the wealth and other differences, from farmer to farmer. For example, in Syria, in the period where we monitor the adoption, you have this phenomenon by which in a given, in 2007, you have these varieties being adopted, other varieties start being produced in 2008, other again in 2009, but then by 2010, those adopted in 2007 disappear. So the process is extremely dynamic, creating a situation which for diseases of insect, is basically out of reach. And this is an idea of the diversity in this material at molecular level. Then with the evolutionary component, it becomes a powerful mechanism of adaptation to climate changes. And it is particularly fit for organic conditions because it doesn't require any change in the environment. And considering that when we're talking about climate change, we're talking about mitigation strategies and adaptation strategies, by combining organic agriculture and evolutionary plant breeding, you actually have a combination of the mitigation effect of organic agriculture and the adaptation effects of evolutionary plant breeding. So basically, instead of having one solution for all the environments, we change the philosophy in having different solutions for different environments. And in evolutionary plant breeding, therefore, it not only brings back farmers in the farmers the control of seed, decreases the crop vulnerability, is a dynamic way of adapting crops to climate changes, but interestingly enough, these populations are not patentable because they change all the time. Thank you. Well, I did discussion with a few people around. And it seems to me that the major weakness of GMOs is that being a quick fix, they are not a stable solution because they actually put a pressure on the organism and it evolves. When I express this concern in public, then the pro-GMOs tells me, he said, well, but this is the same thing as vertical resistance. He said, yes, I know, but that's why a lot of pathologists have been suggesting to breed for vertical resistance, which is much more difficult, but it's much more durable and doesn't put any pressure. And this is exactly what evolutionary population do. In an evolutionary population, you always find a little bit of a disease, some attacks from the insect, but it's never a you should see the incredible efficiency of mixtures in suppressing weeds. So I've seen farmers becoming organic, not because it was a choice, a philosophical choice, because there was nothing, there's no need of using any chemicals. I mean, there are no enough diseases, insect damage, or weeds to justify any intervention. So, contrary to the GMOs, the evolutionary population, actually, they get better with time. While the GMOs are beautiful in the first 2 or 3 years, and then when a new race or a new weed is coming, basically you need to have another GMOs, the evolutionary population do exactly the opposite. They get better with time because they get better and better adapted to that solution. So The alternative to GMOs will be the evolutionary population. There, the seed is fully in the hands of the farmer, and it does not have to depend to anybody. Now, if you think about, and I'm passing this message also to International Center, there could be nobody who can give you a better material than material which has been evolving for 10 years in your field under your way of practicing agriculture. And because of this, and because there is no major plant breeding efforts going towards organic agriculture, you put one of these populations under organic conditions, and I bet that if you are using the selection from that field in comparison to varieties under conventional, then the comparison between the two will change. Well, I mean, it's more or less like the same, the difference in reaction among scientists towards this, this approach. You find a farmer in Iran who was asked exactly the same question: how do you feel investing a piece of land which is basically unproductive just to keep this evolution, this population evolving? And his answer was, but this is an investment in my future and the future of my children. Now, if you have one farmer in that community spreading that message will go across the community much more effectively than if you bring that message. Usually what I do, during lunch I was discussing the very first beginning of this work in Syria, but now what I do when I go to a new place, like a new village in Iran, I never go there and say, I come here with a new solution to your problems. I usually go there and say, well, I've been invited to this place to tell you what I'm doing in other countries. And I try through this method to generate the interest. I said, okay, if other farmers are doing, why not us? So they asked me about the results. And then you may have different solutions. I mean, if you have a situation like Ethiopia, even more Eritrea, with very small farm size, then you have to design the experiments involving the entire community. For example, using incomplete block design, where you're giving each farmer an incomplete block rather than an entire trial. So it basically ends up growing 5 plots. Then you play also with the size of the plots. So basically you try, I mean, in Syria there was not a major problem with land. In Jordan, we had farmers going from half an hectare to 200 hectares. So the half an hectare did not have enough land to host the trial. The 200 hectares guy told us, I don't want to break my system. So what we did is that the small farmer was using another farmer in similar conditions, similar soil type to do the selection, and the 200 hectares guy was involved in the final stage of seed production. So you basically first to understand what is a system, generate an interest by the farmers, and let farmers be much more proactive, so they actually ask you to implement a program. Now it's much easier because I have several examples around the world with different crops. But at the beginning, I was just telling the students during lunch, I started with a farmer community who actually did not understand the question several varieties of barley. The question was translated into Arabic. The answer did not come. I asked my technician, what is the problem? I said, they do not understand the question. What do you mean different varieties of barley? There is one barley. This was a starting point. And then there are different methods that you can use. In that particular case, I told my technician, I said, why don't you tell them what we have in the station? And then he told them, he said, oh, you know, in the station we have 70,000 different types of barley. And then you can imagine the reaction. And so this was a starting point when I said, okay, if you're interested, I said, would you be interested to see all the 70,000? And they start laughing. And so eventually we went down to 200, and this was the first participatory trial I had in Syria. But again, there I exploited a typical Arab habit, which is bargaining. So So we start bargaining on the number of varieties, on the size of the plots. So it was becoming a play, which for them was totally acceptable, because that's the way they behave all the time. Now, in other countries, you can use different methods.
Thank you very much.
This has been a production of Cornell University, on the web at cornell.edu.